So today we're going to do something a little bit sketchy. That is, we're going to talk about how do we sketch curves in polar coordinates. Now, if you remember how we sketch curves in Cartesian coordinates, it's going to be a similar idea. Namely, plot some points and then understand the behavior of how things connect. And then we'll be able to get a good sketch going on. In the meantime, we're also going to go off on a bit of a tangent. And that is, we're going to talk about how do we find tangent lines to polar curves. Because after all, that's one of our favorite things to do in calculus, is saying, hey, there's a curve here. What's happening right at that point? Well, zoom, zoom, zoom. And it comes flat. And what's that line? So that's our other topic for today. Well, let's begin. So we're going to start by talking about sketching. Now, there are sort of two philosophies for sketching. One philosophy is that says the following. If you want to sketch a curve, just plot a lot of points. This is called the computer approach. The computer loves to plot points. Now, how do we plot points? Well, we have our plane here, which I'll put a little grid here. Not that we're using our coordinate system of x and y, just to say, there's our plane. And so what the computer would do is it'd say, okay, what's happening for theta equals zero? All right. It's coming out this far. Okay, how about for theta just a little bit above zero? Okay, it's coming out this far. Okay, how about the next one? And it would just keep doing this for a very, very long time. Many, many choices of theta. And then we would connect the dots. That's how computers do it. What's a better way to do it? Or maybe not necessarily better. Let's just say more human-friendly. A more human-friendly way is to say, look, not all points have equal importance. So what we can do is we can say, let's try to understand the behavior of the curve. So by that, we could say things such as the following. Well, we understand, for instance, we can look at what the curve is doing using our tools, calculus tools, for instance, and we can say, well, over here, maybe it's this far away from r equals this value, theta equals zero. And by the time we hit theta equals pi over two, maybe it's to zero. And we see that our values for r are decreasing. In other words, we're moving closer to the origin as theta goes from 0 up to pi over 2. And that's enough to tell us that we're going to head in. Maybe we're not going to be precise. We won't capture exactly, but we'll get the right qualitative information. And oftentimes, that's sufficient. So that's going to be our philosophy. We're going to say, let's look at a few key points. Let's try to understand the behavior of the curve, and then we'll get a good picture. Now you might say, but which points? Which points are the important points? And in some sense, where are they? Well, where are they is the origin. Okay, now this is important because r equals zero is the center. In some sense, r equals zero is kind of unique in that it doesn't matter what choice for theta you have, you're always going to be at the same point. Now, one thing that can happen, which makes things a little bit interesting, is that we could have r go negative, and we'll probably see a few examples of that as we go along. Of course, that's when we were going to cross through the origin, and wow, interesting things could happen. Now, the other thing, of course, is not only when are you at the middle, but when are you far from the middle. So that's when you look at maxes and mins. And now, if you understand, okay, zero, furthest out, you know, nearest max, mins, and you say, okay, what's happening in the meantime? Am I moving in? Am I moving out? You say, okay, plot the interesting points and use information about moving in and moving out to connect. You're going to get a pretty good idea of what the curve looks like. Now, one nice thing that we do oftentimes when we're trying to understand the shape of curves is we look for symmetry. So symmetry, for example, we might want to talk about symmetry with respect to an axis. So suppose, here we have a shape, suppose we wanted to have it be symmetrical with respect to the x-axis. What would we need to be true? Well, it would need to be the case that if we went down here, we'd have that kind of shape going on. Well, now we just think about how things relate. I think about, okay, there's a point here. It would need to match with the point down there. How do they relate in terms of r and theta? The distances will be the same. Okay, that's fine. What about the angles? Well, the angle, if this is an angle theta, that means I went up by theta. This angle would be the mirror. You went down by theta. And so that's why we have that f of negative theta should equal f of theta. And what that's saying is if you look at it, it says, hey, whether you go in the positive angle increasing or the negative angle increasing direction, you're going to get the same distance out because the f of whatever, that's your radius. Remember, r equals f theta. How far out are you from the origin? If you're looking for something symmetric across the y-axis, well, what would that mean? So if I'm looking for symmetry here, if I have a curve, well, what I'd like is to have something over here. Well, again, just sort of think of the point. I would say if I have a point here, it would mirror image over here. Now, how do the angles relate? The distances to the center will be the same. The angles, well, if I come up an angle theta over here, I can think of it as coming all the way to 180, or pi, as we're doing calculus, and then go back by theta. So that the angles are pi minus theta and theta. So if the distance out at both theta and pi minus theta are the same, that says I've got some nice symmetry going on there. Now, oftentimes you have other types of symmetry as well, and it's just sometimes some things are more clear, sometimes things are less clear. It often is the case that when we're looking in polar coordinates, we'll see r is a function of a periodic function, right? Things like r is sine theta, or sine of 4 theta, or sine of 5 theta. You can even do sine of 2/3 theta, things like that. When you see periodic functions, what that means is that eventually it'll come back and start repeating itself, so that as you let theta roam over all values, not just 0 to 2 pi, eventually it starts tracing over itself. And so one of the things you might ask was, well, how far do I have to go to capture everything? And for that, well, you take a look at it and say, how long until I'm back to where I began? In other words, how many revolutions of 2 pi do I need to go? And then I'm right back where I start. And that tells you how far you need to go. So we're going to see lots and lots of examples. We're going to see a few examples today when we sketch, but we're also going to be talking about doing some applications with polar curves. So we're going to see a lot of examples of polar curves. So we'll hopefully build up some intuition. And right now, don't worry about trying to do anything fancy. We'll just do the basics. If we ever need to do anything fancy, we always can say, well, we've got a computer. We can have the computer help us out, figure out what's going on. So let's move on to our second topic. And our second topic is about tangent lines. Now, how do we do this? Well, we say, you know, we know how to do tangent lines for certain things already. Y equals f of x, yeah, we did that a long time ago. But more recently, we said, we know how to do tangent lines for parametric curves. So here's the idea. Why reinvent something? So what we can do, and this is a very beautiful idea, is it's called reduce to a previously solved problem. So we say, well, I want to understand what's happening with a polar curve. And what you can do is every polar curve, you can transform into a parametric curve. It can always be done. It's a very simple process. Now, you can, of course, go the other way in many cases, though it's not so easy. So how does it work? Well, what we have is x is r cosine theta, and y is r sine theta. So we can say, aha, I can write my x-coordinate as whatever my function of theta is times cosine theta, and y is similar function of theta sine theta. So now I say, look, instead of having to do a polar curve tangent line, I can do a parametric curve tangent line, and that we know how to do. Because we get the point, And that's fine. That's easy. We do what we did before. Okay, we've got the x of theta, y of theta, get out our point. To find our tangent line slope, we look y prime of theta over x prime of theta. Well, now we just take our derivatives, and for example, when we take the derivative of y, the derivative of the first, f prime times the second, plus the first times the derivative of the second. And similar for x, derivative of the first times the second, plus the first times the derivative of the second, and the derivative of cosine is negative sine. And now we're done, because we have our point, we have our slope, life is good. And so we can find our tangent lines. So those are the two ideas. Sketch, look for key points, think about how they connect, and that'll give us a pretty good idea of the picture, and pretty good is good enough. And then the other thing, of course, tangent lines, move everything over here to parametric and use what we've done before. All right, that doesn't sound so bad, because it's not so bad. Well, it's math. When is it ever bad? Of course, the important thing is do some practice, and the more you practice, the better it gets. So, see you soon.